Alright.
Is it too hot in here? Is that the problem? Can you turn the aircon on stronger, please?
This is Hong Kong, after all. We have to wear sweaters indoors. Okay.
Let's carry on. Let's hope everybody else is okay. Alright, so we're talking about Trunara, right? So, you're right? You're not gonna...
I'm just gonna make a comment that... So, like the Rolex issue, right? I think about 80% of the deals, I think, involve a Rolex.
Yeah.
But I think the problem, and I think the mistake most people make, is 99.9999% of people in China go after that 80%.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you're one of those, if you're one of the 0.0001% that goes after the non-Rolex 20%, it's actually easier.
So you said, okay, there's an opportunity, travel, and from that, how do you develop it into what became Trunara? So you're sitting there, you're getting travel, we're in Starbucks travel. What do we do next? You go, it must be advertising driven.
Yeah, so in terms of product, we thought about travel wikis, blogs. It was an extremely systematic approach. Price comparison, which is what we ultimately decided upon. But there was a point where we thought, you know, maybe we should get more into the content side of it. Coming from a media background as well, we thought maybe travel wikis. And Wikipedia at that time was also growing like a weed, and so it seemed like that could be an interesting model as well. But
social media wasn't around at the time, right? So the whole idea of getting involved in kind of travel content was pretty early days.
Yeah, social media was a little bit, but it would have been expert generated, I guess, versus or a mix of expert plus user generated. So we decided that a price comparison model was great because the advertising would be more powerful, because clearly consumers who are doing a comparison and doing searches have displayed an intent which leads to a more likely purchase.
So this is back in 2005. So the idea of people, I mean, in Hong Kong, we've noticed the last 2 years, right? The amount of travelers from China, that FIT, right? So you start off at China. How do you get inventory? How do you get people to put content on your site? Because you're basically a middleman, right? Did you have banks of salespeople who go around China persuading hotels and people like that to get on board? How did you get the content?
That's a good question. I mean, this is something we've built up over the years, so it wasn't something that... And I think when we look back at our product, it definitely was not perfect. But we had the benefit of timing, meaning when we started our business in 2005, almost everyone we talked to thought we were crazy, because Ctrip was already a well-established online travel agency. And yes, we had a different business model.
But Ctrip's model is agency model. It's like I own hotel rooms. I represent hotel rooms and things like that. It's just there.
Right, exactly. So like Ctrip is an agency model, and like we're a media model, right? And so everyone in the industry, so because of that, to be honest, we could make a lot of mistakes over a 2 year period to really build up that inventory and to figure out kind of what works and what doesn't. And the only reason is that we could do that is because nobody thought what we were doing was important. Everyone thought it was game over in online travel because Ctrip was already an established player.
Is Ctrip started by entrepreneurs, or was Ctrip a spin-off of one of the big
groups? No, they were started by entrepreneurs. I mean, Ctrip, even today, I believe is a well-run company and in many ways continues to be entrepreneurial. But what we did was, you know, of course we're also entrepreneurial, but we were starting from such a low base, and nobody thought it was important. In fact, even Kayak, which is our peer in the U.S.
So was Kayak started at the same time or before?
Same time. It was at the same time as us. And Kayak, Kayak also had the same challenges we had. So to give you an example, Kayak had a valuation of something like $30 million.
From the day it started?
From their Series A. And so this is the logic of these asinine, you know, venture capitalists, is like they say, okay, if Kayak is worth $30 million, And you guys are in China, you're probably worth one-tenth. So you guys are worth $3 million. So I'm not going to invest.
That's good maths.
Yeah, because the market's too small, right?
Because nobody on the is on the internet in China. Like at the time, how many people were on the internet in China?
I mean, a few hundred million people.
Small. Yeah. And they don't spend money.
But that's the thing, it's like the logic was so what does that mean? It means, I think it's an important observation, is that we didn't have to face the wrath of Chinese competition. So we didn't have to face the incredible Chinese competition that, so we all know China is an incredibly competitive place. There's a bunch of clones, people trying to kill each other, out-execute each other. But because we were operating in a space nobody thought was important, you know, we had the time to really build those barriers.
So what you're saying is the trick is to find an area that everything is worthless.
Exactly.
Because I've met a few entrepreneurs in China who say that the scariest thing is that you're going to get killed by Tencent, Alibaba, Sina, Baidu, right? So that they're terrified that these guys would come and eat your pudding, or whatever the expression is.
Well, I would add to that, you have the big guys that clearly can clobber you, but then you have a larger number of just irrational smaller players where either money came too easy, they're super aggressive, that could also just totally ruin the market as well. So it's just this massive ecosystem of hyper-competition.
So when you set up Chunar, were there clones within months? Did you have Chunali, Hui Bindo, Narchu? Was it copied?
No, it wasn't, because as I mentioned, nobody
thought
it was important.
They all thought you were
fools. Yeah, everyone said, what is that? That's a silly model. And so everyone was saying, well, you know, we got to do what Baidu is doing, or we have to do what Alibaba is doing. Everyone was trying to do, in fact, everyone was trying to set up a video site back then. So, which was great
potato,
for us.
Right? Potato.
Yeah, Tudo and Youku and a bunch of other ones that since have all blown up, except for Youku, obviously.
So tell us, so you're there, you've got this travel concept of advertising. Does that mean you go to the big airlines? I mean, how do you kick off a business like that? Do you go and persuade China Eastern, or how do you get somebody to work with you? Because you're in an unusual situation that you have to get the content, and then you have to get people to come to you and say, hey, we trust you, you know, you look like a good site. How did you deal with both of those sides?
So our clients were not only airlines and hotels, but also agencies. And what we discovered, there was a bunch of small, mid-sized travel agencies that we can work with. And so our first set of clients, well, on two levels. On one hand, our first set of clients were these small agencies that were desperately trying to compete with Ctrip. And so we were a second channel for them. And then at the same time, surprisingly, Starwood and Intercontinental were they were technically our first two advertisers. And you're thinking, well, how can these big companies, because these big companies hated the fact that they were beholden to the large established players in China. And so they made a strategic decision, and I think they kind of liked this at the same time, you know, or at least they liked Douglas, because he pulled in those deals, I remember.
Hold on, Douglas. He's still here?
I think he's in the... So those two companies knew that they had to nurture the market. So they knew that if we succeeded, it would ultimately help them. And so these guys had a lot more vision than the entire investment community.
So they liked you because typically in the travel industry, 15% or 25% goes to the middleman, right? Whereas
yeah,
you were
right.
saying, we'll only take...
just an advertising fee, right.
So you allow them to make more profit.
Right, so we were... So like the compelling value proposition that we could sell to the entire travel industry. So basically Chunar, I mean, so we're a marketplace. We have demand and supply.
So like an eBay of travel, if you want to do it like anybody.
In some ways, demand and supply. So on the demand side, we help consumers, you know, buy better, you know, find what they're looking for, better flights, hotels, packages, cruises, stuff like that. And then on the supply side now, we helped, you know, these airlines, hotels, and agencies more cheaply reach customers because we had a completely different business model, which was the Google model or the Baidu model.
So you became, for a hotel or an airline, you were a lead generation machine, right?
Yeah, in some ways,
your proposition? You were just like, we will generate leads for you.
Well, like you never want to use the word lead generation because you never get a high valuation for that. But yeah, I mean, okay.
Well, what's the word you use that sounds higher and sexier? Affiliate marketing.
Search.
Community building. Social search. So all right, so you've got, so in the early days, how did you deal with the dominant players? Did you, I mean, was there an issue? Because I know in China there's a lot of, in any business, there's a lot of bait and switch, right? There's a lot of like, you know, show them this price, it even happens here in Hong Kong with property. It's like, you know, show them this nice apartment, but actually we've got one down the road that's really available. Did you find that the dealing with that kind of bait and switch mentality was hard?
Yeah, so unfortunately, bait and switch in China is a respected marketing practice.
What is the Chinese term for bait and switch? Does anybody know? I'd love to know what the Chinese term is for bait and switch. Anybody? We'll find out later.
However, you know, we knew that was wrong. We knew that we could never hold on to our consumers if in fact we allowed companies on the platform to actually do this. So we made a key strategic decision to take responsibility for everyone on the platform. So like if you go to The Economist or like the South China Morning Post and there's like an advertising section, they always have a disclaimer that says, we're not responsible for these ads. And that's how we initially thought about it, coming from a media background. But what we quickly recognized was, hey, you know, the consumer doesn't care. You know, and the consumer's trying to book a flight, find a great hotel. They don't care about if we say we're not responsible for these fake prices.
They lose trust very quickly in what you're doing, right?
Yeah, so essentially we took responsibility, so which means we forced everyone on the platform to eliminate bait and switch tactics, eliminate hidden charges. If a customer wanted a refund, they had to get it within 24 hours. So we did.
So you would refund them? You would take the risk?
No, we didn't take that risk, but we insisted that they have that policy.
So that's quite brave. Did you see your business kind of go down and then suddenly?
No, our business continued to probably grow faster, I would say, because of that.
So okay, tell us about the lead side of it. So you've got the content, you've got these hotels on board. How did the lead side of it work? Did you go to Baidu and buy keywords off Baidu? Did you go into Renren, or formerly known as Kaixinwang, and did you test out social media and you went nuts and you said it's all about influencers, it's all about keywords, it's all about giant posters in Shanghai in Renmin Guangchang. How did you decide what was the best channel to use to generate these search leads?
Well, fortunately for us, we were pretty sophisticated in the early days in online marketing. And in 2005, I mean, you could ask like an advertiser, hey, how was Google working for you? And they'll go, well, what do you mean? Well, how's the ROI? And they go, well, what do you mean? Meaning the level of sophistication of response marketing, lead generation, search marketing was just very, very low amongst potential clients, but that also meant potential.
So they were buying. They were buying by what? They were buying by time. What was what were they using to measure the success of what they were doing?
Well, that's the thing, is they weren't, because they thought it was just a brand thing.
Because
some silly person from the advertising community said, "Oh, it's all about brand."
There's plenty of those. Don't worry. Look, how many silly people from the advertising community in this room? One, two. The one that's laughing is obviously a silly person. Yeah. Two of us.
But the one thing we did, but to specifically answer your question, you know, we, you know, and even today, you know, Chunar has hundreds of different marketing channels that it utilizes in order to get traffic. And of course, Baidu certainly is like a big part of that and very helpful. But back in the early days, I mean, we had a very systematic, organized approach to really acquiring traffic. And again, because we were the first to do it, we could make the mistakes. It was relatively cheaper, and we could go down that learning curve. It used to be you could spend maybe $20,000 in China over a 6-month period.
$20,000 over six.
and become an expert in online marketing in terms of understanding which channels worked, which ones didn't, because just for a very small amount of money, because nobody was doing it. Tracking, monitoring, figuring out what works, what doesn't work, all the optimization stuff. And so we were very, you know, again, like we made a bet that our future was going to be, you know, doing this as opposed to all the brand stuff. And anyways, we didn't have the money to do the brand stuff. Maybe if I had the money to do it, I would have gone to Revan Guanchong and bought those billboards. But luckily, you know, fortunately, we didn't have those financial resources, so we had to do it a different way. And that proved to be, you know, again, extremely valuable, because we had gone down that curve so much faster that when those competitors started popping up, it was like too late. We were just so far ahead of them. We knew exactly.
You mean in terms of all the data you'd collected? But
yeah, totally, yeah.
So
exactly.
So does that mean you hired banks and banks of kind of analysts? Were you hiring PhD mathematicians? So how did you decide to deal with this? Was it, because typically people go down and they kind of program a route, and then you know, you kind of forget about your analysts. You get some creative people and you're done, right?
Yeah, you always want to ignore the creative people.
Very troublesome.
Yeah, so the one thing we did was, so we had a CTO in the company, and our backup CTO, like the number two technologist in the company. It took a lot of courage to do this, but we put him in the marketing department. So we knew that, again, the most analytical, engineering, you know, data-driven person in the company. I mean, someone who could very easily have been a CTO at another company and was definitely a pillar of our and our first employee. We inserted him in the marketing department to be responsible for everything I just talked about.
He became the data guy.
Which is a key talent to have in the company. But we knew it was so important, and rightly so.
So, what was the most efficient channel? Was it search? Was it social media? Was it what was the best way? Was it email? What was the best way that you found to generate leads?
So, this changed over time. So I'm assuming efficiency means cost per engagement or something like that, right?
No, conversion, right through to somebody buying a hotel.
Right.
I mean, your business model is
have
to purchase, right?
Right.
Or is it just
the
referral?
But the referral, how much does it cost for us to generate a referral, for example?
Just a referral, right? Yeah. Not through to the purchase.
So what we found were, initially, some of the most efficient channels were, I think today they describe it as spyware, but back then it was, you know, software, kind of embedded software onto desktops.
I mean like browsers that take you somewhere, like Chihu?
Like kind of an
alternative browser, is that
well,
what you
like
mean?
Well, to be honest, like we actually bought, before Chihu was who they are today, they had another business before, which was a software download platform where you could download a bunch of software onto your desktop, including some of these advertising solutions. And so if somebody, for example, if they were on, at that time, Internet Explorer or Firefox, and they typed in British Airways, maybe our ads would pop up.
So you teamed up with the people who had desktop software.
Right, exactly. And you know, that was a very common user acquisition strategy. And since then, that's dissipated a bit for just a range of different
reasons. But isn't that the model that like Yahoo and Mozilla used? I mean, you in the browser, you search something, and automatically it's a Yahoo search result. That's where they made all their money, right? Or Mozilla made all its money through that.
I think so. I mean, so like we didn't have that platform to back us, but you know, initially, those were the most efficient channels for us, and then over time, what we found were, and keep in mind that the most efficient channels are not the ones that provide the most volume. So we're always in online marketing and user acquisition, or we call it demand generation. So, by the way, if anyone talks to VC, you have to say demand generation now.
Okay. Demand generation.
Yeah. And so
has it got an acronym? Is it DG? Everything has to be acronized.
Yeah, this is the VP of DG over here. So in terms of DG.
DB, the dog's bollocks of DG. DB of DG.
So one of the key principles is you know, there's volume. So volume is always more important than efficiency, by the way, because, you know,
but doesn't that depend on your business model? Volume means more page views.
Just more.
More. Isn't that the Mark Zuckerberg model? Volume. What the hell do you do with it afterwards?
I mean, you can go to, I was just talking to someone from Singapore Airlines earlier tonight. I mean, if you go to Singapore Airlines and you say, I can get you 50 million customers, you know, they don't care how much they pay for it because they're filling their planes, right? Unless the price is outrageous. So ROI and volume are kind of, they have an inverse relationship to each other. And it's the same for demand generation as it is for sales and just so many elements. And so for us, some of these channels, super efficient, but you know, and again, we had hundreds of them, but unfortunately, you know, some of the more pricier channels that could provide the volume were technically not the most efficient. Give us an example.
You're getting very mathematical and
I'm trying to dig
into my A-levels and I'm going like mathematical.
Yeah, so Baidu.
Baidu is a volume or a...
Volume.
Baidu is volume?
So which means the more you spend, you can get more traffic.
Yeah.
But it's going to be costly.
But don't they have a purchase intent?
Sure they do, but still it's costly because it's an efficient marketplace.
So, okay, Baidu. What about social media, like Renren? Weibo, all this stuff. Are they volume or are they?
Nothing. So that was back in.
They're nothing.
So
can I quote you on that? Brit says they're nothing. All right, no, I won't.
Well,
I
guess I have to think if I have a partnership with Weibo.
So aren't they the volume game or the quality game?
Well, they are, but keep in mind that, I mean, these are. It's only recent that we're seeing, I guess, broadly defined, you know, social platforms providing qualified leads. And even then, I mean, at the end of the day, especially for an intent purchase, search is by far the best. This is intent. You want to fly on A to B, you know, you want to fly from Shanghai to Beijing. You know, having that intent through search is so much more valuable. And hence the price is just through the roof where all those efficiencies are squeezed out. Then, you know, on Weibo, where someone's just chatting about, I mean, like those leads just aren't volume, yes, but they're not as qualified, and so the conversion is much, much lower.
But isn't there a kind of retained, you know, well, they talked about when you go to Hainan, you must stay at this hotel.
See, that's the branding thing. That's what they mean.
Yeah.
Again, that's the silly advertising side coming up. I mean, sure, like I guess if you want to spend money on branding, I mean, there's a half a dozen ways to waste your money, I suppose.
So you've killed social media. Baidu's not bad, pirate software is pretty good.
Again, in the early days.
Formerly known as pirate software.
And, you know, social media today, there may be some interesting opportunities, and we're seeing better apps, better analytic platforms, you know, by the large social networks. So maybe now we're seeing a bit of a shift. Of course, it takes time. And you know, to have, you know, Facebook analytics or whatever they call it, and of course, you know, like the Chinese equivalents. So moving forward, so here we are today, and I know there's a number of travel entrepreneurs in the room, and even if you're not a travel entrepreneur, I mean, you have to think about, you know, you have to get demand generation, you have to get traffic, and search is so overexploited, you're never going to make any money just on search alone. So you have to think about the new frontiers. And social is a frontier that gets a lot of attention, but it's been underexploited because no one's made it work yet. Or very few companies have figured out how to exploit search, social at volume. And
isn't that what Facebook is trying to do with the
that's what they're trying
feed,
to do. Yeah,
news
right.
feed?
Yeah, sure, that's what they're trying to do.
So. What about, I mean, some of the numbers that I had here was the amount of people, I mean, travel is a very, you know, sometimes for people like me, very last minute purchase, right? You're on your phone, you're on your tablet. So are you seeing more and more of that? Like, is there a rebirth in search because people are now searching through their phones and saying, you know, I'm looking for a hotel. There's a couple of guys in this room who are like last minute hotel type bookings. You know, the idea that, you know, you need some kind of interface that is immediate, quick, and has the information that you can just go, yes, 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 I've got it, thank you.
Yes, so we're seeing a sea change in the use of mobile. It used to be no one wanted to make a big purchase on mobile, but what we're seeing, I mean, literally over the last 12 months, we're seeing across, and all the travel companies will tell you the same thing, a significant increase in the use of mobile to book product and buy product, which is great, at very, very high price points.
Is this more mostly directly with the hotels and the airlines, or are they still going through the Chunars, the kayaks?
Well, fortunately, you know, Chunar and Kayak have very, very popular apps. Why? Because who wants to download a Starwood app and a Cathay app? And I mean, you just want to download one app, you know, that can really solve your problems. And hopefully that app has the full range of functionality, which is important. And I think some of the innovations we've seen in some of these last-minute hotel booking sites is they've utilized location-based services, last-minute deals, very interesting relationships with hotels to have a very unique mobile product, which isn't anywhere else on the internet. And so that's very interesting.
But do people really turn up in a city and go, oh my God, I'm standing in the middle of the city, where is a hotel near me?
You get enough.
Do people do that?
Yeah, you get enough. I mean, is it a giant killer? No. Can it be a profitable business? I think so. You know, is it? It's going to be a nice, healthy niche. So
why? Well, going back to Chunar, why did Baidu buy you? Why didn't Expedia or Kayak or, you know, some heavily cash overladen organization from America buy you? You are American, right?
Yeah, I'm American.
Tax?
No, so broadly speaking, like I'm not speaking on behalf of Chunar, but, generally speaking, if there's a hot company, they're going to talk to the foreign players, they're going to talk to the domestic players, and then the owners of that company, they're going to have to make a decision on who provides the most strategic value, who provides the most upside. And there's something I heard, and all of us have seen it, is foreign operating companies never succeed in China.
Yeah, even your old employer, Rupert, failed. But Baidu's huge, right? They're a search king, and they've got truckloads of programmers. Couldn't they just look at you and go, let's squash them and do it ourselves? I mean, they had a travel channel. Alibaba has a travel channel. Why do they not just say, squash them?
Well, we had a pretty big business too. So our business was also very successful. And
what was your secret sauce that they couldn't get?
Yeah. So we built a number of barriers. Some of those we talked about already on the demand generation side,
yeah,
going down the learning curve, but also on the supply side. You know, we built relationships with a wide range of suppliers and secondly, those relationships with suppliers were in real time. And so what Chunar offered, which all the search guys can't do, is a real time search.
They talked about real time search for a long time, right? Google had caffeine, or what it was called. You had kind of instant stuff going on. But
we did it. I mean, Google didn't do it.
What is instant search? Can you explain that? What does that mean? That means most search I do, you get a kind of reply pretty damn quickly. My brain's a bit slow, to me it's kind of instant. What does instant mean?
Well, it would be like you want to buy a ticket to Beijing from Hong Kong, and you don't want to know what the price was an hour ago. You don't want to know what it was yesterday. You want to know what it is when you want to buy it. And, you know, prices change.
They're that fluid?
Yeah,
they change minute by minute, second by second.
Sure, yeah. You know, this is which is how the airlines make their money, because they're constantly changing it to optimize their pricing.
Is it as active as a trading floor of say stock, or I mean, is it that active?
The most sophisticated airlines, yes. And so you need a real time search for this.
So you built a system that was real time enough that they wanted that.
Yeah, it's a huge barrier.
You told me that the Kayak were doing the same, but they were slightly slower than you lot. Is that right? What's the system there?
Yeah, that's right. So we were even better than our peers in other markets. And the reason why was because in North America, when you have a number of service providers, you can like buy off-the-shelf product to try to solve your technical goals, but we had to build everything. So we were a much more vertically integrated technology platform than Kayak was. And then the problem with off-the-shelf is other people would buy it too. So you have no competitive advantage. And secondly, you really can't optimize it.
But also in the States, I presume there's a lot more flights and airlines and hotels.
Yeah, sure, it's more complicated, sure.
Yeah.